Good, good.
Precise.
So let me just introduce my collaborators, Andrea Angiuli, who is a grad student at UCSB with me, and Mathieu Laurier, who is a postdoc at Princeton University. So, of course, it's a pleasure to be in Rio, even virtually. I've been participating in Rio conference for 5 or 6 times. I went to Angra del Reis, Búzios, IMPA, and it has always been a great, great time. And thank you, the organizers, for inviting me again and to organize it right now. Okay, so maybe you can go to the next slide.
Yeah, George, can you have a full screen, please?
Okay, so I continue speaking. So the story is like that. I mean, we have these mean field games and we have reinforcement learning. So I want to put that together, but my goal is to show you that in mean field game, you have two sort of games. You have mean field game and the mean field control problem. And I want to show you a reinforcement learning algorithm which can go either way, can compute one or the other of the Nash equilibria, depending if you look at mean field game and mean field control. And I want to show you that this depends on the rates of updating in your algorithm. So this is what I want to explain and give you an example. So reinforcement learning, typically we will do Q-learning, meaning it's a discrete space. And I will cheat a little bit because I want to explain first what is mean field game and mean field control in a continuous time setup, continuous space setup, because this is much easier to explain and this is more known in this setup. So for instance, first I recall in this slide, I recall what is mean field game. So in mean field game, you have two steps. You freeze the distribution mu at t. You have the distribution mu at t in the cost function f. You freeze it, you freeze the flow of distribution, not the distribution, you freeze the flow of distribution, and you optimize in alpha. You optimize this expected running cost, integrated running cost, and it's infinite horizon. The problem that we are looking here at infinite horizon, there is this discounting exponential minus beta t in front. So you freeze the flow, and the evolution is under this stochastic differential equation, dxt. We have a drift. The drift depends on the control, which is supposed to be Markovian here, a function of t and the space, and the flow, which has been frozen, the mu at t. And we don't care too much about volatility here. Sigma is constant, and we have a standard one in motion. You have an initial mu zero. And in a second step, what you do is a fixed point. You try to find the mu at which reconciles the two. So this is a fixed point problem, and that's how you solve a typical mean field game problem. Now, if you go to the next slide, you will see that now we are formulating an asymptotic mean field game, and this is what we will be solving. Asymptotic means instead of giving you a flow of measure mu t, we give simply a mu at. So you put the mu at in the cost function, and you optimize in alpha again, this alpha at. And what you want is that this mu at is a limit of is the limiting law of your state as t goes to infinity. So there is a fixed point, but it's an asymptotic fixed point. We don't require that it match at any time t, but simply at the in the limit t goes to infinity. You next. So if you go next, you see that the control function depends only, the control depends only on the state because the drift has been chosen not to depend on time, and the cost, the running cost doesn't depend on time as well. So basically, this kind of game is that you have a crowd already in asymptotic regime in Nash equilibrium, and an agent is joining the crowd. And it doesn't want to change the behavior of the crowd. This is fine with him. That's his equilibrium to join the already existing equilibrium. So next, again, so next, please. So this is a formulation of the mean field control problem. And this is a classical mean field control problem. So again, what you want is that you update the measure mu t now is exactly the law of x alpha t. So the law is the measure that you put in a running cost is a distribution of the law of the state, right? So there is no fixed point here. So it's updated as you go. And then so this is simply the non-asymptotic mean field control problem. So next, if you can, so of course you can link the two. The objective function for the mean field control and mean field game are identifiable, but in general, they don't give you the same asymptotic. The asymptotic are different. The mean field game and the mean field control give you two different asymptotics, and I will give you an example at the end. So next. So the next is mean field control asymptotic formulation again. So now we put simply the mu alpha in the cost function, and we require that the mu alpha is a limiting distribution of the law of is the limiting distribution of x alpha t, right? And always you have this starting measure mu zero, which is given in the picture. Next, so you can do two next, yeah. Well, the common, yeah. So this is what I just explained. This is simply the point of view of central planner. Central planner has to decide that is at no cost, basically, for someone who wants to join, would be exactly in this equilibrium. So I'm not getting too much into the details. So what we want to compute is these two asymptotic mean field games. So go next. There is still another notion of mean field game and mean field control, which is stationary formulation, where now you include the mu zero. The mu zero is part of your stationary distribution. So you can go next. I will go a little bit fast because we are running out of, yeah. So there is a relation between this stationary formulation and the asymptotic formulation that I gave. I don't want to get too much into the details, but basically they give you the same control. This is what is written at the end. Either for the mean field game, the control is the same, and the for the mean field control problem, the strategy, the optimal strategy is the same. Okay, so now I want to go to Q-learning. So again, Q-learning is designed for finite space and finite time. Infinite time, but discrete time and finite space. So you have a Q matrix. This is a Q which depends on the state X and the action that you are taking. This is a definition of the Q matrix. It satisfies this equation. And if you go next, you will see the relation with the HJB equation, this type of HJB equation. The value function is the infimum over all the action of the Q, and it satisfies the HJB equation. What we are after is the infimum of the Q Q star XA, that will be your optimal strategy. And if you relabel your gamma, your parameter gamma, as an exponential minus beta delta T, then you get your Q star by this formula. You have this formula, so you have to minimize on the strategy running cost from zero to infinity discounted by this exponential minus beta tn, given that you started at state x and with the first action a. So this is what we want to compute. See, if you look at next, so what we will use is what is called an epsilon greedy policy. It means that with high probability 1 minus epsilon, we simply minimize, we take the minimum, the Q matrix. You look at the row of X, and you take the A, which realizes the minimum of QXA. But with a small probability epsilon, you will explore. It means that you will go all over the place by choosing an action which is uniform on the set of actions. So that's called the epsilon greedy policy. Next, please. So this is a picture that you will see in all the books, all the papers of reinforcement learning. So let me explain a little bit. I mean, I have to confess, it took me some time to understand what they were talking about when I entered this subject. It was not my specialty, but I think now I understand. So at the bottom, you have the environment. And the environment basically is not known. Something which is not known. You don't know the dynamics. You don't know even the how the cost function is fabricated. You don't have a formula for that. That's your environment. you are the agent on the top of this diagram, and you are fed with the cost. You observe the cost FTN at time TM. You observe the cost. The environment returns the cost. You observe the FTN. You observe the state that tells you where you are, state XTN. And from that, you are in charge of deciding the next action, ATN, the action ATN. So you you compute yourself the action that you want to take, ATN. And then you feed the environment with your ATN, and the environment does its own stuff, compute the next state XTN plus one, and compute the cost, the cost function FTN plus one, and gives that to you. In our setting, so this is a classical one without the red arrow. In our setting, we have to do something else. We have to estimate the distribution mu tn which enters the mean field game or mean field control. So from your observation xtn and ftn, you have to feed the action atn, but you have also to feed the distribution mu tn into the environment so that the environment can react and provide you the next state and the next cost. Okay, so next please. So this is what I just explained by words. So the difference with the classical diagram is this red extra red arrow, where we have to compute, where we have to estimate this distribution mu tn of the state, and then feed the environment with it. Now, next, I will show you the algorithm. I don't want you to read the algorithm or understand the algorithm. The only thing, and I need to go a little bit closer, on line 5, you will see a rho mu. And this is what is important. This constant rho mu is the speed at which you update the measure mu. The rho mu is how fast you will update the measure mu. Okay, so this is one coefficient. And then if you go a little bit further down, line 7, you will see that you have a rho q. And the rho q tells you how fast you update the q matrix. And basically, this algorithm is exactly based on these two parameters. By choosing these two parameters, you will decide if you want to update faster the mu or faster the q. And that is where you choose to solve a mean field game problem or a mean field control problem. So let me show you the next slide. So the next slide details this rho mu and this rho q. These are the formulas, but if you don't look at the details of the formulas, you have this exponent mu, omega q and omega mu, and these exponents are exactly telling what I am saying. If you want to do a mean field game or a mean field control problem. So let's go to the next slide. You will see some pictures that may be better than any explanation. On the left, you have the rates, those rates. So in reinforcement learning, you have episodes. You do a lot of episodes of this diagram. This is called episode. And on this episode, you choose on the left, you will choose a rho mu, which is less than a rho q on the left. So that means what? That means that you update the mu much slower than the q. So it's like freezing the mu. So it looks like a mean field game. You don't update the mu, you update the q, and you do some kind of fixed points. So this is exactly what the algorithm will do. But on the right, if you look at on the right, the rho mu is larger than the rho q. It means that you update faster the mu, you follow the distribution of the process. So this is more like a mean field control problem. And these are the numbers that we are using next in the example. And they are exactly in this order. And you see the evolution of these rows. And so this is called a two time scale algorithm. And this is exactly what this is doing. So this has nothing to do with slow and fast in volatility, but still there is time scales here and two time scales. So so you can see next. So I want to show you an example. I know that I'm the last thing between you and your Bossa Nova and Caipirinhas, and I want to go a little bit fast and not to get you into mathematics too much. But this is the example that I want to give you. It's a benchmark model we again go back to continuous space and continuous time. That's not too difficult. After that, we discretize the space and we apply our algorithm to solve this linear quadratic problem, which is in continuous space here. And by the way, my student is working on an extension in continuous space. And instead of doing Q-learning, you have to do some neural network arguments. And I'm not going into that, but there is work going on where you do really continuous space. So the cost function is given by these four terms. One term is the quadratic cost, alpha squared. That's a usual cost. If you go next line, the second term tells you that you are attracted to a fraction of the mean. So these are the parameters, at the incentive to be attracted to the mean. If you go one more line, these C3 terms, the C3 and C4, is that you want to be at a target. You have a target for your state eventually. And finally, the last state is you pay a price if the mean is away from zero. That's a choice in our model. It's away from zero. We want to stay close to zero for the mean. We only look at the interaction through the distribution by the mean, M. And so this is a typical linear quadratic problem for which we have formulas. We can go and so, of course, I cited the paper at the end and all the formulas are in the paper. And then we can compute. It's a linear quadratic problem. So we expect that the control, the strategy, will be linear in the state. So now if you show the next picture. So the next picture on the left shows you the mean field gain with the parameters that I cited. So you freeze, you update the Q much faster than the mu. So it's like freezing the mu. And you see on this picture that your reinforcement learning algorithm really produces a good approximation of the linear strategy. On the picture, this line going decreasing line is the theoretical strategy, and we fit it. And at the same time, still on the left, we show the distribution, the invariant distribution, the distribution under equilibrium, and you see that we fit the distribution quite well, and we fit we learn. The strategy on the support of the distribution. Of course, where you don't explore is where the distribution is basically zero. You never go. That's why you have all these outliers in the alpha in the strategy. But it doesn't matter much because you never go there. So we really learn the linear strategy on the support of the distribution. If you go on the right now, this is mean field control problem where we update a lot the measure mu and less the Q. So the first observation is that we learn the linear strategy. That's the bottom line now. This is a theoretical line for the mean field control. They are different. This is an example where they are different. The optimal strategy for mean field control and mean field gain are different. So we learn again the strategy quite well on the support of the measure. But you see a lot of fluctuation, more fluctuation in the estimation of the measure because we update it a lot. So that gives you a lot of fluctuation. One way to remove this fluctuation is to show the same picture by averaging over a period of time. So maybe you can show the next slide. So the next slide is exactly the same, except that we have averaged the distribution over 10,000 episodes, the last 10,000 episodes. And now you see that even in mean field control problem, we are doing quite well in estimating the mu. And on the support of the mu, we learn the linear strategy. Obviously, it's easier for mean field gain than for mean field control. That's one of the conclusions. But the reinforcement learning is really magic in some sense, as it should be, because here we have the theoretical formula. But the algorithm doesn't know. The algorithm doesn't know the evolution, doesn't know the B, doesn't know the drift of the evolution, doesn't know even the volatility. and it doesn't know the structure of F. It's just the value of F, which is given by the environment, which is taken into account. And even without knowing all this, you can learn exactly correctly the optimal strategy. So maybe we can go to the next slide. So let me spend a little bit of time here, because I thought I would have time to do all this in this talk, and I don't have time, obviously. The first extension, which is coming soon, we are writing that, is finite horizon problems. Instead of dealing with this infinite horizon, we deal with finite horizon, and then we know how to do that now. And we can deal with what is called extended mean field game problems. So it means that not only the law of the state is in the problem, but also the law of the control. So this is through the control. It includes the interaction through the control. Why we do that? Because this is quite important in application to finance. And actually, the two applications that we have in mind, and we are working on them right now, this is working quite well. It's a linear quadratic trader's problem. That's a very classical problem in finance, and this is through the control. So the distribution is through the control, and so that is working well. And also, we are working on another problem, which is mean field capital accumulation games. This is interesting for us, because then we get out of the linear quadratic problem, and we want to show that our algorithm is working as well. And as I said before, the work in progress, which is not mentioned here, is working directly on the continuous space. And this is done using a neural network, parameterizing the strategy. And that's, again, work in progress that we are doing as we go. So basically, if you throw the last slide. Yes. So this is the end of my talk. Again, I want to thank you all. I want to thank the organizer. I'm very, very glad to be able to present this work here. Stay healthy. Happy birthday, Marco. Have some bossa nova and caipirinha. Maybe I don't know if this is the right time for everybody, but let's do that. And I will stop here. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jean-Pierre. So, as usual, if you have questions, please write it on the chat, on the YouTube chat. So let me check. It will take some time. So I wanted to know, Jean-Pierre, Two questions, actually rather practical. So one is, what is the main applicability, you think? I mean, what is a kind of best example of a real-life situation? And the second question I have, it is, in practice, are you using an existing package of machine learning like TensorFlow, PyTorch, or is it just coded from scratch?
No, so the next question is coded from scratch. And again, it's a Q-learning. So it's not, there is no neural network at this, this is just Q-learning. So it's from scratch. Mm-hmm. The version with continuous space is a little bit different, and that I didn't talk about that. For the first question, yeah. So these are the two examples that I was mentioning in the previous slide, and that I didn't present because I don't have the time. But this will be out soon, maybe in a couple of months, hopefully in January. This will be out and posted, where we will treat these two examples of the trader problem and the capital accumulation problem. So we have two examples in mind that we want to apply this technology, and that's exactly what we will do in this paper. But again, they require to go to extended mean field game, because in practice, the practical problem, most of them are extended mean field games, so we need to treat that, and we are working on that.
Okay, wonderful. So we do not have a question from the chat. We just have something for you, which is, thanks, Professor Jean-Pierre. So I think this concludes today. So thank you to everybody. And again, great. Happy birthday, Marco.
Thank you.
See you.
So let me thank again all the speakers this afternoon or this day or this morning for some. And thank you, Jean-Pierre, for waking up on a Sunday morning in California and giving this very nice talk. And again, happy birthday, Marco. And we resume tomorrow at the same time we started today with the Peter by Professor Peter Tankov. And have a great day and great night. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye, everybody.